Hey, everybody, what a program today. Another Conversations with Dick Vaughan, and I have Paula Petrunio with me. And I am so excited. I called Paula about a week ago because I saw that she won an award or was voted the best there is in the whole world in the Sturbridge magazine.
Best personal trainer, yes.
Right, best personal trainer. So I called Paula, and she is vibrant, enthusiastic, and exciting. And what does Paula do, you ask? Paula, what do, I ask?
I own Health is Wealth, Invest in You in Charlton, and it's a personal training one-on-one studio. I've been in business for 8 years, and I primarily work with people that are in need of getting healthier and stronger.
Let's talk about getting healthier. What does that really entail?
It makes people start looking at what they're doing.
Well, do you feel most people are unhealthy?
Oh, absolutely. Really? Absolutely. Yes. Most people are very unhealthy.
There you are, folks. You are unhealthy, and Paula and I today are going to get you healthy.
Sounds like a plan.
Go. So now let's say somebody comes to you and says, "Hi, Paula, I'm unhealthy." And you say, "Yes, you are."
No, I don't agree. I ask them, I go through a series of questions.
Okay.
And I take a health assessment on them, and I ask them, first off, what they're doing on a regular basis. And most of them tell me nothing.
Yeah, that's right. They watch TV.
They say that they're doing nothing. Maybe walking, you know, maybe 2 or 3 times a week. But then with winter, they'll be like, well, that was 6 months ago.
Yeah.
So they're not even doing that anymore.
No.
So that's why they need that jump start. So I go over with them, you know, try to get them into a plan as far as starting to work out at home.
Now, let's talk about the plan. Obviously, no two plans can be alike, really. Or are they all alike?
Well, it depends on people.
I mean, they're similar, but...
They're similar, but it's depends on their individual personalized plans.
Yeah.
Because everybody has different needs and limitations.
Right.
As we get older, we have knees, back, yeah. Certain things that aren't working 100% anymore.
Like they used to. Yeah.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah, I got that. Yeah.
You understand, right?
I got it,
okay.
Yeah. I used to be able to run up and down ladders. Now I got to be real careful.
But you can still go up them.
I used to have DirecTV and an internet thing, you know, satellite. So every time I turned around, they were changing the price. So I got rid of them. And so I said, okay. They said, well, those things, what about those? Come and get those things off the roof. No, those are yours. We don't want them back.
They don't come and take them?
No. We just need the unit. Well, I got these ugly things up there. So I got the ladder out. And my poor wife was holding her breath. I went up and got up on the roof. And I had my ratchet, my wrench, and I took those things off and flipped them off the roof. And she was, how are you going to get down? I said, the same way I went up.
You did it.
I did it.
Good
but
for
she
you.
Was a wreck, but it's okay. But you got to stay active.
Absolutely.
The biggest thing, the worst thing you can do is not be active.
Yeah, because your body wants to move. So what's going to happen is by you being inactive, it's going to start to talk to you.
That's right.
And that's going to be bad back. It's going to be the knees. It's going to be the diabetes.
Well, you know, the other thing, too, is what happens to us as human beings, your body deteriorates, and people don't realize that. I have a situation with an L3 and L4 vertebrae that is closed. And that's when I talked to the doctor, they did an MRI, and the doctor says, Dick, that comes with age.
We all have it going on.
That's just happened. You shrink.
Exactly.
And so he says, get over it. Nothing we can do.
Except there is something you can do. You can strengthen the muscles.
You can get on a monkey bar and handle it and strengthen and stretch it out.
Stretch, absolutely. Yeah. Stretch and strengthen.
Yeah.
And that's what I teach.
Good. Now let's talk about food, because that's a vital part of any rehab program.
Yes.
We eat, people eat too much.
Absolutely, and they're not moving.
Yes, and we eat too much.
Right.
And the other problem is, you know what? You know a big mistake a lot of people make, and I preach this. I'm a devotee of this. You go out to dinner, I go over to Mario, my good dear friend Mario.
Okay.
And I'll have chicken cacciatore, you know, and I love it. It's his old mother's recipes. You know, they're great. And then you go home and you go to bed. What? You got to give that food a chance to get down into your system and get digested. And I was reading an article recently that depending on your own self, anywhere from an hour and a half to 2 hours is necessary before you have to, after a big meal, before you go home and jump in bed, because now you're laying flat and you got all that food sitting there.
Well, that's one of the reasons why I don't take carbs away from people, but I tell them not to have carbs after 3 p.m. because they take so much longer to digest. So that pasta meal that you have late at night, it takes...
Oh, no, this is 5 o'clock, 5:30.
But then, it still takes about 4 hours. So now you're looking at 6, 7, 8, 9, 9 o'clock.
I get to bed by 8. See,
So you're sleeping. You're doing nothing.
Okay.
So you better start getting the early bird.
You got to go early.
the lunch special.
but I am proud that I do a lot of turkey. I do a lot of chicken, white meat, and I love fish. I mean, I grew up in Greater Boston, so I grew up with fish.
Perfect. You know?
And when I was a kid, every Friday, if you didn't eat fish, you went to hell. So we had to eat fish.
But you don't have it fried.
No, I don't do fried fish. No, broiled or baked. Broiled or baked. And people love fish and chips. It's all fried food, man. That grease just gets down in there.
It's saturated fat.
One time in my life, I'm going to tell you a story. When I was a kid, I was going to college, and every summer, I would get a job at Johnson's Donuts. I used to make donuts. I was a donut man.
I don't think I could do that.
Well, it's a great job.
I think I would eat the profits.
I'd go in at 5 o'clock in the morning, and I'd work till about 11, be out for the whole day, and I used to fry donuts and cook them. Well, we had these big, we used to put them on a tray, 48 donuts on a tray. You hand cut them, put them on a tray, you know, and then you put them down, you submerge them, and the tray lowers down, and the donuts float on this grease. It's white lard. And you put it in, heat it, and of course it becomes liquid. And then when the donuts are cooked on one side, we have little drumsticks. And we go, boop, 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 and flip them over. And you cook the other side. Well, those donuts are sucking up that fat.
Right. You
know? And people don't think so. Well, every day we had to put more lard back in because of the day before we used almost half of what we put in there in the first place. And where do you think that all went? Into the donut.
Right.
You know, and you go, and then the other thing that drives me crazy, some of these pizza places, you get the pizza home and you got to get a napkin and mop the grease off the top. And if you think I'm kidding you, when you finish it, look at the cardboard thing,
that's saturated with oil
right. that you just put in here. And then you can't get me going on cheese. Don't eat cheese, folks. It's milk and salt. That's all it is. Lots of salt.
Right.
That's all it is. Even though Gilbane gives you a little kiss, it's still good. It's still cheese and it's still milk and salt.
Well, I think it became really popular as a snack because of the protein.
Yeah.
Which is key. You want to make sure you're getting enough protein throughout your day.
But you know, I think one of the great things I've learned is everything in moderation. It's when you overdo things. You know, if you have a little slice of cheese, it's not going to hurt you.
Right.
But if you sit there and gobble it, or you get this huge pizza and you eat all 12 slices, you know, that, and you get extra cheese on it because it's so good and it stretches so nice, and you pour that into you, clunk.
Right. Yeah. Well, I think one of the things I do with
imagine your poor pancreas and liver and kidney that's got to shoot that stuff through.
Oh, it's crazy.
Yeah.
And the older you get, it's a little slower.
Oh,
so
it slows down, yeah. You notice that.
Well, not so much for me because I work out all the time. Well, I take care of it.
That's good. So let's take one of your customers. A person comes in and said, "Gee, Paul, I got to get healthy." So you sit down with them and you do an assessment.
Yes, and then I go over their food. So I find out
is
what
is that scary for you?
Not necessarily. No, I've.
I mean, do they shock you?
No, well, because I pretty much know what people are doing.
I mean, they're all basically
they're overeating.
The same. Yeah.
They're doing that. They're eating too much cheese. They're all drinking too much.
Oh, yeah.
They're overindulging on sweets. And I find a lot, too, is a lot of people are going out to eat more than like that
once a week, twice a week. Two or three times a week.
So they're relying on a lot of fast food stuff. Not necessarily like McDonald's, but, you know, there's a lot of sodium in restaurants.
You know, one of the, I'm so glad you mentioned that. I don't do salt. I try to avoid it. But there, every once in a while, I was out to a place and I ordered a soup, and I like soup. The minute I put it, the first spoon, I said,
salt.
Loaded with salt. And you know what else used to drive me crazy? Is you go out to a restaurant, and they bring the food, and they put it down. And before you taste that food, I've watched it happen, they'll grab a salt shaker.
But it's not even that
And
heavy.
It came out of the kitchen. Loaded with salt.
Right.
And they just went, flump, flump.
Well, that's habit for some people.
But yeah, but taste it first.
I know, but that's just their habit. They've been doing that for years. That's what I found from talking to people.
Oh, look at I used to be on the road doing seminars, Paula, and I used to open my seminar with this way. I'd say, today is going to be a real problem for most of you folks here today. And the reason is because I'm going to ask you to do something that you're going to have a terrible time doing. I'm going to ask you to change. And this is going to just put you through hoops because we are creatures of habit.
Absolutely.
Whatever you do first in the morning, you do first every morning. Okay? Now, I can't tell you why, but when I shave every morning, I start on this side of my face. And every once in a while, I laugh at myself and I'll do it on this side just to be different. But anyway, and I said, if you think change is easy, how many people in the seminar this morning are married? Well, usually 80, 70, 80% would put their hands up. And I'm sure the others had a honey. Didn't matter. So I'd say, here's what I want you to do when you go home tonight. I want you to get in on the other side of the bed and see what happens. Let me tell you, the first thing that's going to happen, what are you doing on my side of the bed? And you say, but honey, I thought this was our bed. It is, but that's my side of it. Move over, and everybody would roar, because it's true. We are creatures of habit, and it is so difficult to break those habits. You know, it really, and when you ask people to change, the toughest thing in the world to do is change.
Yeah, but change is good. Change is hard.
The most important thing you should do, but getting people to, in fact, do it.
Well, when I talk to them about sodium, and I say, you know, I want to go over sodium with you. They go, oh, I never touch a salt shaker. And I go, you don't have to today because there's so much salt in everything.
I was looking for something. I was going to pull a label up. I do a great program with somebody from the FDA, mm-hmm. from my good friend from the FDA. And
even water.
You look at labels. You know, you get these Gatorade and all these things. Sodium, 30 milligrams. So just look at the labels. And if you don't think you're getting salt, you are deceiving yourself dramatically.
It's in everything.
Everything.
Peanut butter.
Yeah.
It's in everything you touch.
Yeah.
And people, so when I tell them that, what I do is I make them go track. I have a tracking app that they use. And they keep track. And the first thing they do with their next session when they come in after they've been tracking for like 2 days, oh my God, I can't believe how much sodium I'm eating.
Yeah.
They have no idea.
The other thing is too, where are you on sugar?
Oh, sugar, not. Those are the two things.
Salt and sugar.
It's salt and sugar.
I was a kid, and I worked in the bake shop. And we used to take a break about 8 o'clock, and we had a restaurant out front. So they'd send in coffee and whatever. And in those days, there was an old Greek. His name was Jimmy Kendall. Well, his real name was Demetrius Panagotis Kandelalis. But we called him Jimmy Kendall. Close enough, you know. But Jimmy was an old-time baker. He was a great, just a wonderful man. And he comes over to me one day and he says, Deke, let me talk to you. I said, you know, what's up, Jimmy? He says, what do? You get the coffee and you put in the cream and then you put all the sugar. No more sugar. Start with the sugar. No more sugar. Oh, he says, I can't do that. He says, how many you put in? I said, 3. Tomorrow you put in 2. So I put in 2 the next day.
Right.
And he let me do that for 3 or 4 days and he made me go to 1.5, then to 1. Eventually, within a week and a half, I never put sugar back in coffee. Then he started on the cream. So since about 1951 or 2, I drink black coffee with nothing else in it. Now, you go to any of the donut stores in the morning, and it's hysterical. They'll come in and I want a cup of coffee. I want a regular. 4 sugars, 16 creams. You know, you don't have coffee anymore.
Half their order is the extras.
That's right. And they're pouring the sugar in it. I said, what are you doing? And then I see them waddle out. So I know what they're doing.
Well, they don't even know. They have no idea what sugar is.
No.
How much, you know, what happens when you eat too many carbs? It turns into sugar. And then you get your extra weight. And then if you eat sugar, it's just going to right turn into the fat. And there you go. But you can't, they're basically having enough sugar in their breakfast at Dunkin' Donuts for the whole day, if not for 2 days.
Let's talk about food for the day. First of all, should people really have breakfast?
Absolutely. Within 30 minutes of waking up.
And what do they really have? What's the best thing to have for breakfast?
It depends on where they're at, but like eggs, 2 slices of toast. It's important to get the macros, which are your protein, your carb, and your protein.
Yeah.
In that one meal. Every time you eat.
Yeah. I do straight unsweetened cranberry. I have to get it in the separate aisle. Cranberry juice. You know, unsweetened. It's just straight
right,
raw.
No sugar.
No sugar,
right.
Nothing in it. Boom. And it's tart, but it's good for you. And then I have, I always eat first. I always have a couple of pieces of toast, you know.
What do you put on your toast?
Nothing.
Okay.
Just plain toast. You know what I've been doing? I use Ezekiel's cinnamon and raisin.
Yeah?
Because I like that. But I also, every once in a while, I'll buy some rye toast that, you know, these nice slices of rye.
Yeah.
And unseeded rye toast. And I'll toast that. And it's delightful. And I just have a couple of pieces. I don't put butter on it or anything. Just eat it dry. And because I do that before I take my pills, because I want something in my stomach before I put the pills in there. You know, so
that's
I do that.
It's a good
that.
Breakfast.
And I have that every morning, usually with a cup of coffee. And occasionally I'll have a Nutribar or something like that occasionally. You know, depends. And what I love, and every once in a while I get them at the Stop and Shop, my Nana used to make them. When Nana would make an apple pie, she used to hold the pie up and she'd take the top crust and she'd have a little, she'd re-roll it and she'd roll it out flesh and she'd put cinnamon in it. And then she'd roll it back up into a roll and cut them. And then she'd cook them. We have these little cinnamon rolls.
Oh,
swirls.
Wow. That sounds pretty good.
So they sell them at, they sell them
at. I do have a sweet tooth.
They sell them at, it's just cinnamon. It's not sweet.
Right.
But, you know, and the dough, of course, the dough is the roll-out dough. But at any event, and every once in a while they sell them over at Stop and Shop and Big Y, and I'll buy them, and I'll have a couple of those in the morning, because that reminds me of my dear Nana. But I'm very, you know, careful, and I kind of watch it, you know.
What about protein? In the morning,
I buy cut pineapple, fresh cut pineapple.
Okay.
And I have four or five pieces of pineapple.
Do you have eggs?
No, I don't. I can't. I'm allergic to. Well, I've never had. I have asthma, and I'm allergic to egg yolk.
Oh. Okay.
I can eat egg whites, but I can't do the yolks. So I just don't do eggs at all. I never had them since I had three eggs the morning I went for my allergy test, and the minute the doctor, this in the old days, he used to put the little pins in you,
right.
And it boop. He said, oh, my God, look at that egg. Don't ever eat eggs again. And I had three that morning, so that was when I was seven. So I haven't had eggs for about a week and a half now.
Well, I primarily make sure that people get enough protein. So that's one of my big...
And what's protein? Give me some.
Protein is usually...
We'll make, like, what, eggs?
Eggs, fish, chicken.
Yeah. Oh, I get
you
my...
do.
I do fish three times a week.
Right, so you're getting it in
and
all
I do
your
omega
meals.
3 every morning. I take those. They're about that big. They're big bombs. I take one of those every morning. B2, B12 I do. I do ED, calcium, what else? Zinc and magnesium.
Perfect. I do go over that with everyone too, as far as seeing what they're getting for supplements.
Yeah, I do that every morning.
Because we do need to assist again as we get older, because we're not going to get, especially with the food
today. Zinc
and
magnesium are very good. People don't realize it, you know. And B12, it just gives you a little pep.
Energy.
Energy, right. You know. And then the omega. Is important, and I have D and E, calcium, and I'm in a study. By the way, I'm doing a study, and I'm in the second year of it, and I have three study pills. I don't know whether they're the real ones or they're placebos, but it's to find out. It's done with Brigham and Women's, and we're studying to find out if raw cocoa is good for you, and can it help you. So I just had a bunch of tests done. They test me every 6 months, they're following me to see if there's any changes or anything. So I just got some information back. They did an MRI and they did a body weight mass and so forth.
And when are you taking that?
I take three of them every morning. Yeah.
Okay.
And I don't know what they are. So, and I haven't died, so it's pretty good.
Well, it seems to be working one way or the other,
right? So I'm okay. So then, now what about exercise? That's vital too, isn't it?
Absolutely. People are just not moving enough. We have to start moving. I mean, everybody, we get up in the morning, we go to Dunkin' Donuts, we get our sugared coffee. We don't even get out of the car. We go through the drive-thru.
Oh, that's not, I don't go to, you know, I won't go to a drive-in. And, you know, I won't wait in line. Let me tell you.
Well, you can call ahead now.
When I was a little kid. No, never mind that. Let me tell you a story. When I was a little kid, Pearl Harbor was, I was 6 years old when the Japs attacked Pearl Harbor. My father was in the First World War. When he heard the news, he called up and went back in, and he was a commander in the Navy. My father was gone from 1941 to 1946. So I was the man of the house. But because my father was a commander in the Navy, he used to call every Sunday night and talk to us, ship to shore, you know, it'd be gobbled and everything. And I remember all that. And so I was the oldest of three kids, so I was the man of the house for 6 years. But we used to get, they used to have ration stamps, but we'd get all we wanted because my father was in the Navy. And the Navy, every night the Navy man would come out from Boston to check to make sure we were okay, because, you know, they were always worried about us telling the Germans something, whatever it was. So they'd come out to make sure we were okay. But I'd have to go up in line, I'd have to go up to the store, like my mother would say, oh, they got cheese up the corner, or they got beef, because everything was rationed.
Yeah.
And we had, but I had stamps. So a lot of people, you know, they had, so I'd walk, but I'd never get there at first, so I'd have to stand in line and wait until it came my turn. And I vowed that I would never, ever, when I got older, ever wait in line for anything or anybody ever again.
And how'd you make out with that?
Very well. I'm a prompt freak. And if I go to an event and they have a buffet, everybody rushes up, go, oh, the buffet's up.
Right, right.
I sit back and wait. And when there's nobody in line, I go up and they're all, by that time, they're refilling everything. So I go up and get everything
I
need.
Perfect time.
And come back and sit down. They've all finished. It doesn't matter. I just sit and take my time. I will not. If I go to a restaurant and there's a wait, I leave.
You can call ahead.
I don't wait for anybody to take my money. You can't sit me now. You can't squeeze us in. See you later. Well, it's only going to be 10 minutes. Too long. You know what I know? There's two other restaurants down the corner that are waiting for me. Off I go.
Wow, you've been doing that a long time.
Yes,
good for
I
you.
Have. For
quite
a long.
I'm not a big stand in line fan myself.
No, I don't wait. And I'm on time. I can't stand being late for anything.
Yeah, that's pretty much, I try to do the same thing.
Oh, I have to
like
tell you.
I don't like people being late.
No, I had an appointment.
Especially for their appointments.
I had a dental appointment about 6 months ago. I had a dental appointment. And it was 9:30, and I got there at 20 past 9, and they didn't get me until 10 minutes of 10, so I really let them have it. So yesterday, I had an appointment this morning at 9:30. So yesterday, this little Kaylee, who's a delightful young lady at Aspen Dental down in Auburn, got a phone call. She says, hi, Mr. Vaughn, this is Kaylee. Hi, Kaylee. She says, you have a 9:30 appointment tomorrow morning, and I just texted the schedule, and we have an emergency coming in that they called just now, and they're coming in tomorrow morning, and we're going to be backed up. So can I make a suggestion? Don't come till about 10 minutes of 10.
Oh, I like that.
I gave her a hug and a kiss when I saw
That's it. Perfect.
What a great thing. She remembered. She said, I know how upset you were you had to wait. I said, because I have a philosophy. My time is very important to me. And when I have to wait 20 minutes for your hygienist, that backs my day up. And that means I'm going to be late everywhere along the way. Or I got to make up that time somehow. And I said, plus I'm paying you. Why should I have to pay you to wait for me?
Exactly.
I said, if I didn't get there, you'd be upset. You're going to charge me anyway, right? Yeah. Well, it's the other way around. I should have a free appointment if you're late.
I don't think that's going to happen.
Oh, they didn't want to hear that.
No.
But anyway, but I'm excited about this because I think, in fact, I know there are people sitting out there watching us today, Paula, who, hear what I just said? Sitting out there watching us today, Paula, who desperately need to make a phone call and chat with you or stop in to see you. How do folks get a hold of you? Let's tell them that.
You can go to my website, which is www.healthiswealthinvestinyou.com.
Could you make it any longer?
But it's the name of my company.
Oh, okay.
So think about it. Health is wealth. Don't we agree?
I agree.
Right?
I'm in.
What other, it's number one. I used to sell real estate for a living, 26 years. And I thought I was selling the most valuable asset that people were buying. Then when I got out of real estate and I went into training, I realized this is the most valuable asset.
You know, nothing beats being alive.
No, and there's something that does beat that.
What?
Being healthy and alive.
Okay, well,
Because there is a difference.
My point was, if you're not healthy, you're not going to be alive in the first
place.
No,
that is not true. There are a lot of people that are unhealthy that are alive.
But they're just waiting.
They're just waiting.
Knocking on that door.
And no, that's what I teach people. Do not do that. You need to get up and move. You need to put muscle on your body so therefore you can be healthy and alive. There's a difference.
Oh, absolutely. Nothing. Look, you know, you don't want to be unhealthy. You don't want to be laying in a bed
It doesn't matter how much money you have or how many houses you have if you can't get to them.
That's right. Think about it.
If you can't get out of the chair and get to the room, what good is it?
It's not good at all.
I mean, we've all been sick, we've all been down, we've all had an injury, and we know how bad that is. Just not to be able to move the way we want to move. So that's what I tell people to focus on. Remember those times where you couldn't move when you wanted to? Well, now that you can move.
Move.
Move. Get up and move. Do something every day. 30 minutes every day.
30?
Yes.
What happened to 20?
I changed it.
Okay. Good.
Because I'll probably get 20 most of the time, so I'm going for 30.
30. That's right. That's right. So 30 minutes a day.
30 minutes a day.
That's all it takes.
And you know what? I have to tell you that some people look at me like I'm crazy. Like,
what I do is this. I take my car, and you got the little thing, you know, they got the little thing on your speedometer.
Yep.
So you can drive it and see how far you've gone.
I think they always had that, no?
Well, no. They had the one that just automatically did it.
Oh,
now
you
can push a button and restart it anytime you want.
Okay.
So what I do is I like to walk, find out a mile. So I drive until I get a mile around the lake where I live.
Yep.
So now I know, or around the block.
Exactly, your mile.
So I now know that if I go twice around, I've done a mile. Okay? So what I do is my wife and I will go out at night, and we'll go twice around. You know, and now I know I just did a mile. So it usually takes me about 20, 22 minutes, 20, 18 minutes, you know. And we don't stop and chirp to people. We just wave.
Right.
We keep going.
Good.
And
oof.
And we walk. Well, I don't go that fast.
Well.
Easy, easy.
Well, I'll
easy.
Cut you a little slack.
I'm 103, easy. Easy, but anyway. But the thing that really, and I've shared this with you earlier, frustrates me, is I just can't do, as we age, you just simply can't do the things you used to do at the same speed you did them.
But you can do them.
Oh, yes.
You just have to realize that.
Take my time.
Not beat yourself
up.
I
have a big project. I saw this thing I wanted, and I bought it. It's a cupboard. And, of course, it came from China, so it comes in a box. And guess who's got to put it together? Hickey. So I got my instructions. Now, 20 years ago, I could do that in 22 minutes. Boom, 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 done.
Right.
Now, it's going to take me an hour, but that's okay, because I'll do a little bit. I'll take a rest for a few seconds, do a little bit more, and you know, there's 96 screws have to go into the back, you know the deal. But I'm looking forward to it, because it'll be fun. Now, I'm also a mummer. I'm in the Furco String Band of Philadelphia.
Oh,
been
nice.
Been in the band.
I've
been in the band for over 60 years.
Yeah. The Hoyoke St. Patrick's Day Parade.
I used to play the banjo. My thumbs are gone. So now they make him up front. I dance up front. I dance. I have my fancy costumes. We do those suits are 50, 60 pounds a piece, you know. So I paraded this year. We paraded in Southbridge in May, and I did that parade 2 miles. And we did Palmer in last fall, and I did that parade in Palmer. So I still march with the band, and I MC the concert. So I keep active, you know.
It's key. Look at it. That's why you're healthy.
Well, I'm struggling. I'm healthy. I got a terrible cold, but that's okay. Had this thing since Christmas. But the weather's been up and down like a yo-yo. I mean, everybody's raving about tomorrow. It's going to be 65 degrees. It's going to snow next Thursday.
That's okay. It's winter.
I know.
You just got to enjoy the day that we do have.
Yeah, here's the good news. Every day gets 2.5 minutes longer now.
I know. I do love that.
And then we get the first weekend in March. We whoop. Turn the clocks ahead.
So people can start walking outside.
Yes, and get back out. That's right.
Get back out,
that's
moving.
Right. Yeah, you got that. And you know what else is great? You ever been to Wrentham Village Outlet? That's great. You know why that's great?
Walk.
You can walk. Because you go from store to store.
Well, it's great for other reasons.
You do four or five.
I do love the shop.
I got a great pair of Uggs yesterday. Stole them. Uh-huh. It was so great. Everybody rent Monday for the big sale.
Oh, President's Day.
I didn't go Monday. You wouldn't be able to get a place to park. I went yesterday morning, 10 o'clock. I got there, had the place to myself. I got some great bargains, but I got a great pair of Uggs. They were 100, and, I don't know, 80, 90 bucks. I got them for 45 off.
Wow, that is a good deal.
Oh, yeah. And by the way, I got a sad story about Uggs, though.
Why?
You know Uggs from Australia? They ain't. They're made in China now.
Oh.
They're made in China.
Well,
a lot cheaper
isn't?
To make them in China.
Right.
You know, but first of all, Uggs are wonderful, but they're way overpriced.
I don't really like them.
You don't?
No.
Oh, I love them. These are navy blue velvet, suede, navy blue suede ones, the high ones.
Yeah.
Oh, they dazzle those people. But anyway, you know, but it's great exercise. So you go shopping like that. It's great. It's great for you.
Just moving. Just getting out and doing more
every
day.
We got 2 seconds. Tell them how to get a hold of you.
My cell phone is 508. 397-3576.
There you are, folks. It's another Conversations with my great friend and guest, Paula Petrunio. It was here with me, and we're going to have her back in a month.
Sounds great.
Can't wait.